It's one of the oldest questions. How did the universe and everything we know get its start? A lot has happened in the nearly 14 billion years since the Big Bang. But what if we could study the earliest days of the universe, today, here on Earth? And what if we could use that same understanding to help solve some of the most pressing questions in technology? For more than four decades, scientists have used a special type of helium in the chilliest conditions on Earth to test some pretty confusing and cutting-edge concepts in modern physics. Today in Otaniemi, a little pocket of the capital region of Finland, we're gathering some wisdom from Aalto's historic low-temperature lab. We're going to find out what two experts have to say about the building blocks of the universe from a little droplet of helium-3. Welcome to Aalto University.
Hello to everyone joining us. Good evening, good morning, wherever you are. I'm Kate from Aalto Communications, and this is part two of our series, Way Out There, on research touching the place we call outer space. Last week we kicked off at Metsähovi Radio Observatory, where we turned our heads up to the sky to look at distant radio galaxies. Today we're a little bit closer to the Earth. I'm talking to two physicists from Aalto's historic low-temperature laboratory, which was founded in 1965 and continues to be one of the leading research centers for low-temperature physics. If you're not sure about what that means and what on earth it has to do with outer space, you're in the right place. Today we're talking about what are the connections here and what can the study of a very special type of helium tell us about the universe and its evolution. So I'd like to introduce senior scientist Vladimir Eltsov and Professor Emeritus Grigori Volovik. Thank you for being here.
Thank you. Hello.
Hello.
Maybe we can get started. When I talk about helium, a special type of helium, I'm talking about a form that you have been studying quite in depth called helium-3. Now, can you tell me what exactly helium-3 is?
Well, helium-3 at room temperature is a gas, a simple gas, which is made of atoms, not from molecules, and each atom contains two protons, a neutron, and two electrons. So from quantum mechanical view, it's a fermion, but at room temperature, this doesn't matter for its properties. But when you cool it to minus 270 degrees Celsius.
So very, very cold.
Cold, but not so cold as compared to what I'm going to say next.
Okay.
Yes, it becomes liquid. And then if you put this, cool this liquid 1,000 times more, then it becomes a very special liquid, so-called superfluid.
A superfluid.
Yeah, so could I have a glass of water?
Yes,
so
yes, we have a glass of water here for you.
So in fact, liquid helium looks like essentially like water. It's just transparent liquid. And in our setup, we have this kind of glass with liquid, which is probably coldest glass in the Earth and maybe in the whole universe.
In the whole universe.
Maybe. If there is no intelligent life anywhere else who is able to cool these substances to so low temperatures. Yes. And it looks transparent, just like this water.
Mm-hmm. When it's very, very cold. When it's superfluid.
Yes, when it's superfluid. Yes, thank you. But in fact, it has very complex internal structure. Mm-hmm. Yes. And this complex internal structure, you can identify things which you can call particles.
Right.
Yes, like they're called usually quasi-particles, but they're similar to particles in the universe we live. And you can identify some interaction between particles, which is produces some fields, like electromagnetic field or gravitational even field. And so it's like a little universe, universe in the glass liquid.
A universe in the glass.
Yes. Exactly.
So you can find many, many interesting things there.
Yes. And then what is actually interesting in this universe is that we kind of able to understand where laws of this physical laws in this universe comes from. And they're coming actually from the thing which is known as topology.
Topology.
Yes, topology.
That is not a term that most people are familiar with. So what does it mean?
Yeah. So we can try to give some simple idea of what topology means.
Mm-hmm.
So could I have this donut?
Yes?
Yes. That's an example of topologically non-trivial object. Yes. When you look to the donut, you see that it has some ring and some hole in it. Yes, some hole in it. And, well, maybe some twist of these things around it. And the fact that it has this shape is encoded that it has this hole. So, for example, we can have a mug. Yes?
Yes. Yeah. So we have another mug, an empty mug.
Yeah, empty mug. And then you see that there is a hole in this handle, and everything else is solid. So that means that donut can be transformed if, for example, it will be made from some substance which you can mold, can be transformed to a mug without doing any extra holes. Yes? So we can say that these objects have the same topology.
They have the same topology.
Yes, exactly.
They're made out of totally different things.
Yes, but they have the same topology, and that's what's important. And what is even more important, then when you look at the space, thank you, or in this glass of water, which is transparent, or glass of helium, actually, which is transparent, you don't see any donuts, of course, there. But there is some topology hidden there. When you look at the donut, you see it because the particles are at certain places. So there are no particles where there's a hole, and there are particles where there is a ring, and that's called topology in the real space. Mm. But there can be also topology encoded in the way the particle moves around. So there can be a uniform liquid at the first glance, but the particles move there in a very special way, which forms these topological structures in momentum space, how it's called.
Okay.
Yes. And that's what make this helium in its superfluid state a very, very special substance because it has very rich of these topological properties, which really you can find a parallel within the universe.
Okay, and how does it relate to space? Like, where would you find these in space?
Topological properties or helium?
Helium.
Helium, yes. Yes, where we get our helium from. Yes, the helium, this three isotope, yes, it's maybe abundant in stars, but it's very little of it on Earth. And actually, the helium which researchers are using is produced artificially as a decay of some radioactive materials, in particular as a decay of nuclear bombs or warheads in nuclear missiles.
So you're actually taking something.
Well, not we, but of course the people who will sell us this helium, they're collecting this gas which produce when this nuclear weapon decays, and from that extract helium-3, which later can be used for experiments.
Right. Grigori, maybe you can comment a little bit about the overall study of helium-3 and a little bit how long, in general, it's been going on, that people have been interested in it.
Yes, the people have been interested for already 40 years, starting from the discovery of that. It appears that it has very many connections to our vacuum. Of our universe, because we have the similar particles like quarks and neutrino and electrons, and we also, as Volodya said, we have the fields. And the reason for that is that the topology is actually much more rich than the topology of this donut. It's more complicated topology like that, for example.
Mm. So we're looking at a keychain of sorts.
Yes. And looking at the topology, or topology, as Volodya says, some hidden space, mm-hmm. you can immediately say, for example, that in that topology there is no gravity. There is no gravitational field. Mm-hmm. There is no elementary particles. But in this complicated topology of the helium-3, we have all the signatures of our universe. Fields, gravitational field, and elementary particles. And this is all come from topology. And also we have another topology in real space, as Volodya said, cosmic strings, which are created during the, which should be created, have been created, but they are still observed, not observed, during the cool down of the universe from the Big Bang.
And now you're referring to a very new paper that came out
Absolutely.
In Nature Communications, actually
today,
from your research group.
Yes, So what we found actually is continuation of the previous work where we discussed observation of the so-called half-quantum vortices, which looks like a Lie string. So it means when you go around this vortex, then you transform to antimatter. And that's why if you go around and meet another one who didn't go around, you annihilate each other. And this is a Lie string suggested in high energy physics, in cosmology, but only 2 years ago we have found them in experiment. But now in this paper we found even much more interesting situation when we have these two Lie string and the so-called Keble wall appears between that.
So it just appears.
Yeah, yes. And when you cross the Keble wall, then you go to the mirror to the world outside of the mirror, inside the mirror, how it's called, okay. On the other side of the mirror.
Yeah, so some very interesting phenomena there.
Yes, but just it not just appears. So that's a very important other connection is that in helium, superfluid helium 3, you can have different phases, so different states where laws mm-hmm. of physics are different. And when we're speaking about our universe, yes, when it cools from the Big Bang, it is believed to be going through a sequence of these phase transitions, like this water ice transition. Yes, it's an example of phase transition, but through actually sequence of different phase transitions, and laws of physics have been changing. So particles might have no mass above the transition and becomes massive below the transitions, and other laws are changing. And this is an example of the ball, which is actually appears a result of this change of physical laws in the transition. It's really a physical reflection of the physical, of the ones which you can actually measure, of this, how the laws are changing, of physical laws changing between different states of matter.
So yes. you can actually explore a huge amount of topics by studying helium-3.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. And one of the things that you have been considering and that you feel, or that I've understood that helium-3 can provide an answer to, is one of science's biggest questions. That we've known for some time that the universe is expanding, but that the rate of expansion we've understood in the last few decades, that rate is actually increasing. So there's this problem or discrepancy between what has been theorized and what has been actually observed. And this is called the problem of the cosmological constant.
Yes.
So what does helium-3 have to say about this problem? How big is this discrepancy, first of all?
Yes, the discrepancy is very huge. So you see, our vacuum is not empty, the vacuum of our universe. So it's not just empty space. It is filled with virtual particles. So they do not exist in real world, but they exist virtually. So they come out and come back, but still they provide some energy and some pressure. And this pressure is so huge, if you calculate the pressure which comes from this huge vacuum states, that you cannot survive. So the problem, and the pressure is by 120 order of magnitude bigger than what was the pressure which was measured.
Okay.
And you mean should probably explain that this pressure is the one which actually pulls,
makes
the universe to expand.
Absolutely, yes, right. It's
so
expand because of the pressure.
Based on theorization, we would expect a much greater pressure and much bigger stretch.
Yes. But we are still alive. So what is the reason for that?
So if it was actually correct, this theorization, then there would be no life.
Absolutely.
Okay.
No possibility of life. Too huge pressure. But when we look at helium-3, we can immediately see what really happens. That in helium-3, we also have the same situation, that we have these virtual particles. They really have a pressure. Which is big, if you calculate it, not such as big as in the universe, but big enough. But experimentally measure that is practically zero. And the reason for that, and we know the reason for that, that in addition to this virtual particle, we have the real atoms of helium-3. and their pressure completely, due to thermodynamics, completely compensate these virtual particles. That's why this is a hint for solution of the main cosmological problem, that all these virtual particles, all this huge pressure, is just compensated by some, what is called, some particle atoms of space.
Protoatoms.
Protoatoms. Almost complete cancellation between them actually demonstrates that we really have in the deep vacuum, we have some kind of protoatoms which compensate that.
Right. So the study of helium-3 can really provide real answers.
Real answer both to cosmological problem, why it is small, why it is of the same order as we measure now.
Mm-hmm. So it's a very important thing to use this yes. substance for study. Now, if you're wondering about how people are actually studying helium-3 in the lab, we have a clip. I went to go visit the low temperature laboratory in person a few days ago, and I spoke with one PhD student named Jere Mäkinen. He showed me around the lab, and he explains very well what's going on there. So if we can roll the clip, we'll come back live to you in just a few minutes. So we're here at the low temperature laboratory on Aalto University's main campus. I'm talking today with Jere Mäkinen, a PhD student in applied physics. Great to be here. Thanks for showing us around.
Yeah, it's nice to see you, Kate.
Yeah, nice to see you for sure. We're standing in front of a big blue cylinder. Kind of looks like a thermos. I know there's a lot of equipment here. It spins from time to time. Tell me what this actually is.
Yeah, so this blue thing is, as you mentioned, it's essentially a big thermos. So it's designed to keep everything that is inside cold. So it's not at the room temperature. The room temperature doesn't go inside the thermos bottle, but it keeps the thing cold. Unlike the thermostat, it's designed to keep things hot, but it works the same way, right?
Okay, so it keeps the cold in.
Yeah, it keeps the cold in, or the hot out, whichever way you think about it.
So it gets pretty cold in there.
Yeah, indeed. We can actually cool the coolest part of our system goes to something like 1/10,000th of a degree above the absolute zero.
And absolute zero is?
That's about -273.15 Celsius.
-273.
Yeah, it's well colder than outside, even during the winters.
Even during the Finnish winters, yeah.
Yeah.
And how do you actually get it that cold?
Well, that requires a lot of stages. So the easiest thing to understand is that this is a thermos again. So we fill it with liquid helium that cools it down to 4 degrees of Celsius above the absolute zero. After that, there are a couple of other mechanisms, and the final cooling stage is actually a big chunk of copper, which is cooled down initially at the very high magnetic field, which is why we have the paper clip here. So
right, the paper clip. This is something that I've noticed before. So tell me about this paper clip, because it looks a little bit out of place.
Yeah, this is actually one of our security measures. So
okay, I know that you have other security measures.
Certainly, but
but this is one of them.
Yeah, so when we are preparing for measurements, we actually cool down the huge chunk of copper in high magnetic fields. And the magnetic fields are so high that this paper clip is actually sucked into this blue D-bar here. And then we know to be careful around the cryostat when there's a very high magnetic field. I mean, if the magnet quenches, which means it heats up very fast, it boils a lot of helium, which turns into a gas, and then it creates a huge pressure inside this D-bar. So we don't know not to do anything silly when this paper clip is close to.
So basically, this paper clip, this very simple office tool, is a warning that there's huge amount of pressure in there.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
You know what's going on.
No, it feels a magnetic field.
Right.
So yeah, which can be turned into a huge load of energy, which then evaporates this helium that is inside this blue bucket.
Right.
And that builds up a huge pressure if it evaporates really fast.
Okay, yeah. And that's what we want to avoid.
Yeah, that's what you want to avoid.
So you use helium-3 yes. in this?
This bucket is filled with helium-4. It's the most
helium
common.
Four.
In on Earth, it's the more common isotope, which is used to vapoon balloons and so forth, mm-hmm. 1st of May balloons.
Yeah.
And then inside there is a couple of centiliters of liquid helium-3, which is very rare. It's only actually produced in nuclear weapons. Mm-hmm. And that's what we are studying. So on Earth, it's very rare, although it's very common in the universe as a whole. It's the second most abundant element in the whole universe, actually.
Helium-3.
Yes, most of the stars, for instance, contain a lot of, or all the stars contain a lot of helium-3.
Mm-hmm.
It's used as a fuel for nuclear fusion.
So when it comes to this lab, what form is this helium-3 in?
It's most of the time it's gas, but only within this particular dewar we can liquefy it. It only liquefies at 3 Celsius degrees above the absolute zero, so it's already quite hard to liquefy.
Yeah.
And some tens of liters of gas are then turned into this few centiliters of liquid, which is then essentially in the middle here, as you see this yellow taping.
Mm-hmm.
It's sort of in the middle of this yellow taping.
And when it becomes liquid, how much is there actually in there?
Not much. So there's maybe a couple of sugar cubes worth of liquid helium inside.
Okay.
In total, so.
Yeah, so when you're working with helium-3, you're working with a tiny amount, essentially.
Yeah, it's a tiny amount of liquid. It's a
right.
huge amount of gas, but it's still, as you compress it, it's, mm. it's the same with water vapor. I mean,
mm.
boiling a liter of water creates a lot of vapor.
Right.
Right. Which you notice when you go to sauna.
Especially when you go to sauna, indeed.
Yes.
We're here in the pumping room. Jari is going to explain to us what this all is. What are we standing in front of?
Yeah, so once the helium-3 is not in its liquid state, but rather its gas, we need much larger space to store it. So we use these old beer cans, essentially.
Beer cans?
Yeah, or yeah. water kegs, these are called.
Right.
Which are then connected via tubes to the dewar. So when we evaporate the liquid, we store the gas in a similar kegs as these ones.
Yeah, and you're dealing with a lot of gas, actually.
Yeah, some hundreds of liters at most.
Yeah, so you need a lot of room.
Yes.
And a lot of kegs.
A lot of kegs. Of course, they had to be emptied first.
Yeah. I wanted to ask you, Jere, about the mini hurricanes that happen in here.
Oh, yes. So one of the unique properties of helium-3 is that it turns into so-called superfluid, which means that it can flow without friction. And one of the unique properties of superfluids is that if you rotate a bucket of it, like so, instead of a normal bucket of water, for instance, it responds to rotation by creating a multitude of miniature hurricanes or tornadoes that are all identical. And like water bucket, it creates one big whirl in the middle.
Yeah.
So this is only possible with superfluids. And that's one of the, that's the reason why we have built this rotating thermos.
So you're cooling it down so that you can make it a superfluid.
Yes.
And with the superfluid, you get mini hurricanes.
Yes, which you can study.
Yeah.
They have many interesting properties.
Yeah. And what kind of things have you been studying with these mini hurricanes?
I have been studying, for instance, turbulence. So turbulence is one of the unsolved problems of classical physics.
One of the big ones, right?
Yeah, one of the big ones. So it's related to, for instance, weather models, so transport of water and oil in pipes, or how much your car uses or consumes fuel and so forth.
So all kinds of really practical everyday.
Yeah, so most of the energy that humankind consumes is used to fight turbulence in one way or another.
Okay, so most of the energy that humans use.
A huge chunk of it, yes.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's the most, but it's
but
a very
it's
large
there,
portion. Yeah.
Yeah, and that's what you've been hoping to study with that.
Yeah, that's one of the things. Because once we can create these identical mini hurricanes, we can simplify the problem considerably. And we are hoping to be able to provide some insight into classical turbulence as well by studying the simpler system.
Right. So you're about to defend your doctoral thesis. You've
yes,
been working
indeed.
Here at the low temperature lab for some time,
yeah.
Working very hard, I'm sure. What is it that got you interested in this field?
It's the variety of the physics. So even though I'm studying a single gas or a liquid consisting of single type of atoms, you can still create many different types of physics. So you can, for instance, study turbulence. So you can study very complex flows using the liquid. You can also approach something like how was the universe formed, for instance.
Yeah, and that's what we've been talking about. Yeah.
Yeah, indeed. And then again, you can also study something like topological quantum computing, or you can create some exotic particles or system that should contain these exotic particles that haven't been found yet, that could be utilized in the quantum computing scenarios. That is another thing that people are working hard to achieve at the moment. And there's a multitude of different things you can study using this simple system. So this is a poster by Volovik, where you can see that helium-3 is in the middle.
Yeah.
And then there are all these different subfields of physics that you can study by using helium-3. So this gives you an idea how rich
really
a system it is to study.
It's a real universe of study.
Yeah, it's a indeed, Volovik has a book called Universe in a Helium Droplet.
Yeah, exactly.
And this is the reason behind it.
Now, Yere introduced at the very end of this clip how helium-3 is really a whole universe of study. And this is something that you, Grigori, have been working on for quite some time. You've written a book called The Universe in a Helium Droplet. And you've had a long career studying the connections between condensed matter physics, cosmology, and high energy physics. So I was wondering, over these last few decades, what is the biggest finding that you feel that helium-3 has offered you?
Yes, there are many different findings, but it's very difficult to choose which one of them. Maybe the origin of physical laws is the most important, because looking at helium-3, which has the same topology, like this donut and...
Right, and so we have the mug.
Yes.
And the donut, yes.
And the donut.
They have the same topology, and in the same way, helium-3 and our universe also have the same topologies, and that's why they have the same physical laws. And in one of the phases of helium-3, which looks like our universe, we really find the origin of the physical law, such as Newton law or gravitation or whatever. So, this is really the fundamental thing which comes from helium-3.
Right.
In addition to cosmological constant problem, of course.
Yes, of course. And this is something that you've been studying yourself for some time.
Yes, actually, from the very beginning, I mean, from the first discovery of superfluid helium-3, and in Landau Institute, I had discussion with a very famous topologist, and that's why I applied the knowledge from them to helium-3. We found with Vladimir these Alice strings, and we want to measure that in helium-3. And I was invited by Olli Lounasmaa to the laboratory, where we started to work on different topological defects, which we really found a lot. There is no such substance which contains so rich, so many different types of the topological objects, which corresponds to different types of the cosmic strings. But the analogy, actually, it was once I have read some strange paper by Holger Beck Nielsen from Niels Bohr Institute. I think it was also in the 70s. And then this was very strange, that the physical laws can be just emergent phenomena. And he gave some example of that. It was very interesting, but it was very strange, and it was very abstract. But then it appears that in helium-3, just the situation which he predicted. And that's why there are a lot of connections of helium-3 to the other physics, actually, because of that. So I also studied superconductivity, because some topology of superconductors also have similarity in helium-3. So we have even some very important effect in superconductivity, and also liquid crystals high-energy physics, so I contacted with many different people in cosmology and high-energy physics. We have common papers, not only just on connection between helium-3, but really on the structure of the our universe.
Right, so it can really reveal rather many secrets about how things got their start.
Yes.
Yes. Now, that's going back quite a bit in time. What if we fast forward to present day and think about the future? Vladimir, what do you think about what helium-3, the study of helium-3 holds in store for us now and into the future?
Yes. So one, of course, is this aspect of learning, which Grigori stressed. So actually, Professor Volovik now has a very prestigious advanced grant from European Research Council, which is a very important question. So could I have this ruler so I can demonstrate
absolutely.
It? So let's see. So we have this ruler, and we can study how, for example, it bends. Yes, mm-hmm. So we can kind of build elasticity theory by observing this ruler. But we also know that the ruler is made from atoms. Yes, at a small scale. So could we just, by observing this, say, its elasticity at large scale, could we derive this atomic theory at small scales? That's really seems to be impossible. But of course, we're doing proper experiments. You can do it. And so what is now work for which we are funded with from this European Research Council is actually to try to make the same breakthrough for a quantum vacuum of our universe. So we have we know the physical laws, but they're still at sufficiently large length scales. So could we, by doing the parallels, how this transformation from large scale to small scales to atoms happens in helium, can it give us a way to build, well, for theoreticians, of course, the adequate model of a quantum vacuum which works also on small scales. And then one can look what happens or predict what will happen, for example, inside a black hole or some other interesting physics.
So that's, you can really explore a lot of different topics with that.
Yeah, so if you can create a working model of quantum vacuum, which works at microscopic scales by learning from helium-3. That's one aspect. But I also want to stress another aspect. For example, in the connection with this paper on these walls and vortices, which we have been discussing in the first half.
The one published today.
The one which is published today, yes. So actually, these half quantum vortices, or at least strings, which Grigori has explained, have also another interesting property. Inside of their centers, or how we call about vortices, their cores, they have very special objects called Majorana modes or Majorana fermions, and this is now believed to be one way to make, using these modes, to make a reliable quantum computer.
A reliable quantum computer.
Reliable quantum computer, yes.
That's very exciting.
Yes. And for that, one important process one have to do, one have to somehow braid them or change their places around. So there we have many vortices and many modes, and then you want to somehow move them around and this way to do quantum computation. And nobody knows how to actually do it properly. Mm-hmm. And so these walls, which we can now, between these two vortices, which we can create or remove on control, they actually provide some quantum channel for interacting between these modes. And so maybe they can be used in future for this kind of things. But maybe that's all technical details. But what is interesting here, that originally these walls existing between vortices, they were really like something, an Earth prediction from theoreticians about some outer space which has nothing to do with reality.
Okay.
And now when we kind of observe them in real lab, mm-hmm. yes, it might possible that this eventually will result in some useful applications. Yes, so that's actually another route. So learning helium to, studying helium to learn something from cosmology, mm-hmm. or maybe using cosmological concepts to bring them to real life, which made something useful.
Yeah. So you need to study the universe, the making of the universe.
Well, to study, or there are these very bright theoreticians theorizing about the universe and inventing some good concepts which can be also applied in condensed matter physics and maybe later in applications. And another thing is which relates to this contribution of helium to understanding of origin of physical laws. Now, when we kind of understand where the laws comes from certain topology, then the obvious thing is, could we create a system where physical laws would be the ones we wanted?
Okay.
Yes, could we make a system, for example, which will transfer current at very high densities at room temperature without dissipation, or do some other things? Yes.
Mm-hmm. So you're talking could about
we, yes, room temperature, for example, superconductivity.
Exactly.
Yes. But it's a kind of general. Could we make a system which has physical laws inside for these quasi-particles, which is living there, that the one which suits us, which we want?
That would be very convenient
yes,
for a lot of things.
Yes, that would be very convenient. And now it's really a hot topic. Mm. It's called designer materials or engineering, this topological materials, yes. And helium here is one example. Grisha told that there are a lot of things which naturally gave us. But by still manipulating it, by placing it in special confinement or whatever, we can create even more features and actually learn how to make these systems with desired physical laws inside them.
Well, that sounds incredible.
And that's one part of a large so-called European Microkelvin Platform collaboration, which is funded from this year also by European Commission. Mm-hmm. And this is kind of a small part with which we are involved in collaboration with the UK institutions to learn how one can build this new physical laws in helium on purpose.
And this is something that you're involved in. It's an international collaboration
yes, exactly.
with many people involved.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
Yes.
But these are big questions and they require a lot of work.
Yes, exactly. And so to summarize, there are like these two future directions, learning, including learning about our universe, and maybe also learning how to make something practical.
Yeah, that sounds excellent. On that note, I think that we've learned a lot about helium-3 and the implications its study has for our understanding of so many things. So I want to thank you so much for being here with me today.
Thank you.
It's been fantastic to hear from you once again. We're going to be back next week with Jan Prax, who's going to talk to us about new space. It's a different perspective. We're going to hear about how more and more players are going out of our atmosphere and what we can do to make a sustainable space industry. I'll see you there. Looking for a fresh approach to science and research? Subscribe to Aalto University's YouTube channel.